So we are in Acts chapter 4 tonight. By the way, we're going to have some cake after the service just to celebrate their 25th anniversary. Hopefully there's enough to go around. We can pray that God multiplies the cake. I'm not sure if it's biblical. But Acts chapter 4. The Bible says in verse 1, "Now as they spoke to the people, the priest, the captain of the temple, and the Sadducees came upon them, being greatly disturbed that they taught the people and preached in Jesus the resurrection from the dead. And they laid hands on them," not in the good sense, "and put them in custody until the next day, for it was already evening. However, many of those who heard the word believed, and the number of the men came to be about 5,000. Let's pray together. God, thank you tonight for your word. God, we're blessed tonight that it is your desire. God, you saw tonight before the world was ever even made. And I pray you'd help us to see your sovereignty through that lens, God, each and every time we're gathered together and the Holy Scriptures are open and your people are seeking your face in prayer and praise. Father, it is your divine intention to pour yourself into our lives. God, we want nothing less than to draw near to you tonight. We're hungry, God. We're thirsty. We pray that you'd quench our thirst tonight with your presence. We pray tonight that you'd satisfy our hungry hearts with your word, heavenly manna. We pray tonight, God, that you'd stir our hearts with boldness in the last days that we're living in to be witnesses filled by your spirit and fearless. God, would you grant us that? And tonight we pray that, Lord, just in that unique and very personal way, like you always do, that you'd speak to our hearts, God, and help us to see Jesus tonight, we pray. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You know, as we pick up the story in Acts chapter 4, and by the way, just to kind of give you a little heads up, I'm going to be gone for the next couple of Wednesdays, and so what we're going to do is Pastor Mike's going to be teaching Acts chapter 5, and then Brandon's going to be teaching Acts chapter 6 the next week. And then the week after that, you know, we're doing worship and scripture reading every five chapters, but we're a little off order. Hopefully you guys are all right with that. I know you control freaks are going to have a major problem with this. But we're going to do our worship and scripture reading after chapter 6. So just to let you know, that's how it's going to roll out. But as we're picking the story up, remember, this is a very young church. In fact, I think young would probably even express an oldness that would be beyond the church in its current growth right now. It's really in its infancy, and there's been explosive growth. You know, as we look at verse 4, and as you add things up, as we get past verse 4, and commentators add things differently, I would say there are at least 7,500 people in the church, 8,500 people. And so there's just been this explosive growth. There has been spirit-filled preaching. There have been miracle signs and wonders that have been done by the hands of the apostles, obviously as they were filled with the Holy Spirit. But there's this backstory that's brewing right now, and the backstory is opposition. In fact, if this was a modern-day movie, all of this would be leading to a spiritual showdown at the OK Corral. That's really where this is all going, because remember, it had just been a number of weeks since Jesus had been crucified. And sometimes I think as we go chapter by chapter, we can lose the context of history. We're all the way into chapter 4, and we think, well, you know, maybe it's months or maybe it's years, but really, we're just a month and a half past the crucifixion of Jesus. So think about that, and it's important that you think about that, because that was fresh in the minds and the hearts of the apostles. And what we're going to see tonight is that this church, in its infancy, with everything good that was going on, was faced with some very serious opposition. And tonight, as we work our way through these verses, we're going to learn how to deal with opposition in our life. And when I say opposition, I'm not talking about just obstacles or difficulty. I'm talking about the unbelieving world and the spiritual realm fighting against the work of God through our lives. Now, the reality is this. I say that, and you know, there are many people who are not experiencing any opposition for their faith at all as Christians. I'm not saying that that's any of us, but I do believe that we're living in this Christian culture that is looking for a comfortable experience. I don't mean to be negative tonight, all right? But I just want to make some observations, and I hope that these observations aren't necessarily true about us. I think that it is kind of in vogue right now within the Christian culture to be comfortable, you know, to not rock the boat, to kind of, and no one would really frame it like this, but to kind of just blend in. I kind of feel like that is an unspoken desire in the Christian culture that we're marinating in. And, you know, I'm not talking about, we're going to talk about opposition. And I want to encourage you, this is going to sound really weird, but I want to encourage you this week to create some opposition in your life, all right? Now don't, you're like going to go and you're going to go get yourself fired from your job and you're going to come to me when I get back from Israel, and you're going to say, hey, this is all your fault because you told me to stir up some opposition. So listen, what I'm saying is this. You need to be Spirit-led, but you need to be fearless, okay? I'm going to give you some principles to deal with opposition, but you've got to have some opposition. So I want to encourage you this week to really pray through how you can press out a little bit, all right? How you can be bolder about the gospel. And not necessarily in a way where you're wanting opposition, but at least that you're not avoiding opposition. And I'm not talking about, when I'm talking about opposition, I'm not talking about opposition because of our political position. I'm not talking about opposition because we've chosen a side in the culture war. I'm talking about opposition because we are boldly, fearlessly proclaiming the name of Jesus Christ. You're going to see tonight that this is what the opposition was from in the lives of the apostles. It wasn't because they were pressing a particular religious viewpoint in a sectarian sense. It wasn't because they'd taken a political side on something. It wasn't because they were really hammering some cultural issue that was volatile, and they were taking a position on it. What we see tonight is that there was opposition in their life because they were fearless when it came to the name of Jesus, and they expressed that with all of their heart. So I want to encourage you this week just to press a little bit, all right? Press a little bit and be fearless about sharing the name of Jesus, and pray that God will give you opportunities. You know, there may be, in fact, areas in your life that God has been knocking on the door of your heart, and he's been saying to you, hey, you need to share. You need to be a little bolder. You need to take a step out, and you know you've been hesitant, you've been maybe a little reticent to do that. God's going to give you an opportunity this week. And then when the opposition comes, I'm going to equip you tonight to know how to deal with it. So verses 1 to 4, this is what it says. Serious church multiplication, 120 in the upper room, 3,000 at the first message that Peter preached. Second message after this dude gets healed at the Gate of Solomon, 5,000 more are saved. And so very full day of ministry, think about this, very full day of ministry that ended with them getting thrown in jail. Like, how would you like that for a full day of ministry? I was preparing and I'm thinking, you know, my day has not really ended that bad, I have to say. You know, here we are together, fellowshipping, and none of us have been thrown in jail yet. But they probably absolutely overwhelmed with the amazing things that God was doing. And this is how that day ended. The Sadducees, which really comprised the majority of the Sanhedrin. Remember, the Sanhedrin was a governing body, both religiously and politically in Israel. That was the body of men that were responsible for crucifying Jesus Christ, composed mostly 70% plus of Sadducees. Remember, there were three religious sects in Jerusalem, Israel at the time, the Pharisees, the Essenes, and the Sadducees. And so the Sadducees were in the temple. They, with the captain of the temple, came upon the apostles that had been preaching as these people were being saved. They laid hands on them with the guy that had been healed, and they brought them into custody. They threw them in, and I'm going to just use this terminology, but they threw them into jail. It was evening, and so they spent a night in jail, and the next morning they were brought before the religious leaders. Now this is how the story goes, verse 5. And it came to pass on the next day that their rulers, elders, and scribes, as well as Annas the high priest, Caiaphas, John, and Alexander, and as many as were of the family of the high priest, were gathered together at Jerusalem. So the governing body is there. Annas, remember, we talked about this to some extent in the gospel according to John. Annas was not the official high priest. He was the father-in-law of the current high priest, who was Caiaphas. But he basically had been handing off the high priesthood to family members, five different family members, over a long period of time. So realistically, everybody knew that Annas was sitting at the top of the religious food chain. And so they had the apostles gathered together. This is what happens, verse 7. And when they had set them in the midst, they asked them, "By what power or by what name have you done this? What's the authority that you're doing these things by?" Then Peter, note this phrase here, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, "Rulers of the people and elders of Israel, if we this day are judged for a good deed done to a helpless man, by what means he has been made well, let it be known to you all and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified," don't you just love this guy, "whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, by him this man stands here before you whole." Look, he's not done yet. "This is the stone which was rejected by you builders, which has become the chief cornerstone." Still not done yet. Hang on. Wait for it. Here it comes. One of the most amazing verses in the New Testament. "Nor is there," you should memorize this, "nor is there salvation in any other, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved." Okay, this is good. So it just gets more and more intense. I want to backtrack, and I want you to check a couple things out. It begins, obviously, with their concern about the name. What authority is it? I think they knew the name, but they wanted to hear the apostles say it. Peter is, what happens to Peter right before he speaks? What happens? He is filled. Wasn't he already filled? Didn't he already get filled in Acts chapter 2 on the day of Pentecost? So listen, he is refilled, if you let me put that prefix on there. He is refilled with the Holy Spirit. I'm saying that to you because it's important for us to remember that the filling of the Holy Spirit is not just a one-time event in our lives. It is definitely not to be misconstrued with the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. And I said this to you, remember, we're talking about synonyms here. When we say baptized with fire, when we say baptized in the Holy Spirit, when we say the Spirit coming upon us, when we say filled with the Spirit, all of those are synonyms. They're speaking of the same thing. When God's Holy Spirit empowers a believer to be what? To be whatness? One person? Well, come on, guys. For what? Filled for what? Filled to be a witness, right? Filled to be a witness. He'll be a witness unto me in Jerusalem. All right, you guys are like, if I'm going to grade you tonight, we're not doing all that good. So let me say this. It probably is a teacher. Who cares? Who cares about the World Series? Okay? You just hang tight on that. You'll find out what happened with the debate later on. And the Patriots will win tomorrow night. So let's just set that all aside right now, just so you know. Okay? He is filled before he says a word. Now listen, this is not just a moment of preaching to multitudes. This is in dealing with opposition. So do not reduce the filling of the Holy Spirit just to crusade-like events. The filling of the Holy Spirit is for every element of the ministry. In other words, listen, you can't do anything apart from the filling of God's Holy Spirit. Even when Peter's standing before the Sanhedrin and he's just about to give a defense, he's just about to explain whose name it was that they were preaching in, before that even happens, there's a filling. So When you stir it up this week, okay, when you stir it up this week, make sure you're Spirit-filled first. There's an exclusivity here to what he says, and it's very clear as you look at Peter's preaching. By the way, we don't have the time for this, but as you take Peter's preaching, this is the third message that he's preached already in the book of Acts. If you look at every component of his messages, all of the same components are there. They're communicated in different ways, but it's really the same message that he's conveying. I want you to remember, he knows. Okay, he knows before he drops the J-bomb. He's about to drop the J-bomb. That's the name of Jesus, by the way. You're like, Jose? Jimmy? Julio? No, Jesus. So before he drops it, he knows it is going to be like a bomb. He knows it is going to be like a bomb that is going to go off, because remember, these guys hated the name of Jesus. They hated the person of Christ. And saying that, he knew, would ultimately incite them to anger. Now, God gave him great boldness because he did not back down a single inch on his message. So, point number one, if you're taking notes tonight, I'm a kind of a point-oriented teacher, I know that, but I want you to catch these points, and they're just single words tonight. Number one is boldness, all right? Number one is boldness. When it comes to opposition, when it comes to you and me saying, hey, I'm not just going to seek a comfortable life, I'm not just going to blend in, I'm going to proclaim the name. He's done so much for me. If he went to the cross for me, how can I not be a witness for him? I want to be that type of witness that stirs it up in the most godly sense. Number one, there has to be boldness that comes from the Holy Spirit. And notice this, that ultimately, Peter's message, it was not about himself. It was not about a religion. It was not about the name of a church. It wasn't about his personal ministry. It was all about Jesus Christ. And he was bold enough to claim exclusivity concerning salvation coming through Jesus. And by the way, if you struggle with that, listen, this is the message of the New Testament. And all of that is tied to things that Jesus said, like, no one comes to the Father. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. So number one, you need boldness. Number two, you need Christ-likeness. Verse 13, now when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were uneducated and untrained men, they marveled. So this is, you got to catch this, it's so good. So these highly trained, heavily educated, religious people are looking at these, and these are the words, uneducated and untrained. By the way, the word uneducated is agrammatos, which means illiterate, and untrained is the Greek word idiotes. I'm not kidding. It is idiotes, where we get the English word. So this was their perception. Who are these illiterate idiots? This is literally how they saw these men, as illiterate idiots. We certainly know that they, look, and those two words are used specifically because one means unlettered and the other one means untrained. And so this was what was happening in the mind of these leaders. There was a spiritual aristocracy, and they had bypassed, these apostles had bypassed their system. Like, no one was allowed to do these things, especially in the temple, without rabbinical authorization, without being authorized by the Sanhedrin. And so these spiritual aristocrats are like, hey, wait a minute, you guys, we didn't train you, and we didn't teach you, you've bypassed our system. But there was something about them that was amazing, because notice this, they marveled. And then this was their conclusion. They realized that they had been with Jesus. Isn't that good? I love that. Let me read it again. And they realized that they had been with Jesus. Now, let me say this. This verse, verse 13, is not advocating an anti-education attitude in Christianity. All right? Sometimes I hear people say, as they look at this verse, you know, seminaries are unnecessary. Bible colleges are irrelevant. All we need to do is be with Jesus. And I would say to you, you can be with Jesus at Bible college, okay? Not all of Bible colleges. I know some that probably wouldn't happen. You can be with Jesus at seminary. So the Bible is definitely not espousing an anti-education philosophy, but all of those things, this is what all of those things are about. They're all about spending time with Jesus Christ. I think this was the greatest compliment. And this was what was happening. They're like, wait a minute, we've seen this before. Right? They're listening to the apostles, and they're looking at how they're behaving, and they're like, these guys remind me of somebody. Who is that? Oh man, they're just like Jesus. And so the person of Christ had so influenced these guys that they actually began to look like their leader. I think that this is one of the greatest compliments anyone could ever give to a believer, to walk away and say, you know what? You are just like Jesus. There was such a deep influence that the Lord had on their life. You guys know how this works. When you spend a lot of time with somebody, you become like them. You spend a lot of time with your husband or with your wife. This is the beauty of differences in a marriage. This is the intention of God, that you become a balanced person. That person's been placed in your life to be a helpmate. So we see that in the marriage relationship. We see that in friendships. For better or for worse, the Bible says evil company corrupts good habits. So that can be in a good sense. You know, you can become like the people that you hang around. I see this with people and their dogs sometimes. Don't you notice that? Like, don't you notice how dogs and their owners start to look alike after a while? Did you ever walk into someone's house and you're like, this is just kind of weird, you know? And probably because, well, never mind. You don't need to think about that tonight. But the bottom line is this. This is what we need. We need Jesus, all right? We need Jesus. Our goal as we're ministering to people is not to conform them into our image. Our goal is to see people made into the image of Christ. This is the whole point of Romans chapter 8, where God says through the Apostle Paul, all things work together for good for those who love God and are the called according to His purpose. Why? Because He has predestined us to be conformed into the image of His Son. And so when it's all said and done, what are you supposed to look like? You're supposed to look like Jesus Christ. I hear in a lot of leadership circles, I hear people say something like this. Well, you know what you need to do? You need to make little yous. You need to make little disciples that are just like you. And I think, God, please, never, right? One of me is enough. The world does not need another. What we want to do is take the hammer and chisel, set it down, and let the Holy Spirit do the work in people's lives. You know, you don't have to play the role of the Holy Spirit. Yeah, but Pastor, I've got opinions. Let me tell you what you can do with your opinions tonight. No, I'm just joking. You're like, it doesn't, we need to be Spirit-filled. We need to be led by God, but we need to be so very careful about the things we say to people. A lot of times I think we're more apt to share our opinion than we are to share words of grace that bring edification. And we want people, when it's all said and done, to bear the image of Jesus Christ. So that's what they say as they're looking at these guys. Verse 14. So it's undeniable that they'd been with Jesus, notice, and seeing the man who had been healed standing with them, they could say nothing against us. These guys got a problem on their hands because they're like, man, these guys, they've got a lot of wisdom, and there's a lot of boldness, and then look, this dude's been radically healed, and we can't deny that because he's been living in this condition for decades. And so they send the apostles away, and they have their own little holy huddle, verse 15. But when they had commanded them to go outside, out of the council, they conferred among themselves, saying, what shall we do to these men? For indeed that a notable miracle has been done through them is evident to all who dwell in Jerusalem, and we can't deny it. So what? They're trying to politically work their way around a very difficult situation because there was a miracle that was done that everybody had affirmed was from God. So this was their conclusion. But so that it spreads no further among the people, let us severely threaten them. (Laughs) Let us severely threaten them that from now on they speak to no man in this name. So I want you to think about a couple of things, okay? This is the same group of guys that thought they stamped out Jesus Christ. They thought, hey, we'll just deal with this Jesus thing by nailing this guy to the cross, and once we nail him to the cross, it'll be done and over with. Did that end the ministry of Jesus Christ? And so they're thinking in this situation, hey, I know what we'll do. We'll just really threaten these guys, and then they'll just stop preaching in the name of Jesus. Did that work ultimately for these guys? It did not. Does it ever work when the world pushes the church down? Does it ever work? You know, if you look at church history, this is what you'll see. You'll see that when the unbelieving world persecutes and attacks the church, seeking to destroy it, all that does is cause the church to grow, okay? This is a spiritual axiom. I want you to get this in your heart and mind because this is so critical for you to understand. I think a lot of times we are hesitant to share the gospel because we're so afraid of what might happen. But this is what happens when persecution comes against the church. Every time somebody opposes the church and tries to press it down or kill its believers, what happens is the church just ends up multiplying to the extent that Tertullian, who was an early church father, he said, the blood of the martyrs is the seed of the church. So the more you kill, the more blood that's spilled, the more the church grows. And I say that to you tonight because you need to know you have nothing to fear. Or you have nothing to fear. You don't have to fear opposition. You don't have to fear persecution. You don't even have to look at the current condition of our country and think, oh my gosh, what's going to happen? You know, Christianity is going to be stomped out. No, it's not. Voltaire thought, you know, because he was such a philosophically brilliant person, he thought, you know, I've created arguments that will undermine Christianity. 50 years from now, Christianity will cease to exist. And 100 years after he said that, his house had been converted into a building where there was a printing press producing Bibles and sending them all over the known world. You know, God's got an amazing sense of humor. So it is literally impossible for the world to stamp out the church. Notice what happens here. Verse 18, so they called them and commanded them not to speak at all nor teach in the name of Jesus. But Peter and John answered and said to them, this is such a great answer. Whether it's right in the sight of God to listen to you more than to God, you judge. For we cannot but speak the things which we have seen and heard. So when they had further threatened them, they let them go, finding no way of punishing them because of the people, since they all glorified God for what had been done. For the man was over 40 years old on whom this miracle of healing had been performed. So the third thing you need, okay, when opposition comes, when you stir it up, when you press the edge, when you're spirit-led and you proclaim the name of Jesus and you get some pushback, the third thing you need to remember is obedience to God. So the opposition came. These guys said, hey, we're going to severely threaten you. Later on, they get beaten because the threatening didn't work. And so they get physically beaten. By the way, they thank God for the privilege of getting that beating in the name of Jesus. Chew on that one for a while. But their response to the opposition is this, it's obedience. And the thinking is so cogent, it's so clear. This is what Peter says with John. He says, this is what you're saying. This is our option. We either obey God or we obey man. Which do you think we should do? What do you think we're going to choose? The right thing for us to do in this circumstance, I mean, Peter could have said, you know, I don't want to stir things up too much. I don't want to put us in a place where our safety somehow is in jeopardy. So I'm just going to modify. Hey, guys, you know what? I know it was probably a little over the edge, my preaching. I didn't mean for 5,000 people to respond to the message. So I hear you, you know, I'll take it easy on sharing the name of Jesus. He absolutely does not do that because for Peter, listen, reduce it to this, for Peter and John. For Peter and John, it was an issue of doing the right thing, okay? It was an issue of doing the right thing. It all boiled down to this, do we obey God or do we obey man? When it comes to us being a witness for Jesus Christ, it's more than just a suggestion. It's more than just something that comes at our own personal convenience. It is an issue of what is right for us. It is an issue of what is right. Being obedient, being Spirit-filled, being Spirit-led, and being bold is the right thing. Caving to fear, having an attitude of what is in my best interest, and then modifying what God has told me to do based off of that fear or elevation of my own personal self-interest is the wrong thing. Do you understand what I'm saying tonight? And so when we're thinking about this, because I know sometimes we look at this and we think, well, that's really, man, that's hardcore Christianity. Those guys were hardcore, man. Those guys were like Navy SEALs, live on the edge, extreme Christianity. That's how we view this. In fact, we would use the word radical. This is not radical Christianity. This is normal Christianity. This is the normal expectation of God. This isn't radical or out of the norm or beyond what God expects. And I'm not saying that we have to be those types of annoying people who are just looking to cause trouble. There are people like that. I've known people like that over the years. I've shared this with you. I had a good friend in Bible college. His name was Twofold Todd. And we called him that because every time he asked a question to the instructor, he'd say, now this is a twofold question. But he worked at the ice skating rink up in Twin Peaks, Olympic ice skating rink, and he was the guy that would take the money and exchange the ice skates. And every time he took the money before he handed the ice skates, he'd give people the gospel. So like they're like, give me my skates. He's like, hang on a minute. Before you get your skates, I'm going to tell you something. They're like, give me my skates. I just paid for it. And he's like, no, not going to happen. So one day what happened is he came to me and he's like, dude, I got fired, man. I got fired for the gospel, bro. I got persecuted because I'm a witness. I said, dude, you got fired because you're an idiot, okay? That's what happened. I love you. I love you, but that was not the right way of going about it. Be faithful in your job. Do what you're being paid to do. Honor the people who are over you, but in that process, look for divine appointments where you can lovingly share the truth that God has placed upon your heart that people need to hear. So I'm not saying to you, just go out and be belligerent in the name of Jesus Christ. You need to be Spirit-led, but listen, it's not about convenience, and it's not about our best interest. It's about what is right. And so I want you to think about that, okay? So obedience is number three. Prayer is number four. Notice what happens, verse 23. And being let go, they went to their own companions and reported all that the chief priests and elders had said to them. So when they heard that they raised their voice to God with one accord and said. So just put a pause on that, okay? They all come back. They're all together. They give a report. And then when everyone who's gathered together hears, this is what they do. They raise their voice to God, not in one accord, but with one accord. The word raise there is very interesting. And I know from our perspective, it looks like it's something that's being pushed up. And in a sense, it was. Their voices were being raised to God in prayer. So they were pushing up these prayers to God. But the Greek word actually means to take from the earth or to pick up. And so I want you to see this in two ways, all right? They're in one accord, so they're single-minded. They're all affirming that this is the right thing to do. It was the will of God that all of this went down the way that it did. While they, as the people of God, are praying together with one accord, lifting their voices to God, this is what God is doing. God is gathering. I love this picture. God is gathering their prayers like flowers from the earth and receiving them to himself, all right? That's when we pray together. I want you to really think about this, and you know, we're dialing in prayer for this ministry over the next couple of months, but I get so concerned that sometimes we don't see prayer for what it really is. Sometimes, you know, we reduce it to this formality or this function. We call it a spiritual discipline, which absolutely it is, but you guys know it is connection with God the Father, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, God Almighty, the maker of heaven and earth, the King of the universe, right? The King of the universe. The Bible says that our prayers rise as incense to his throne. I know there's some old hippies in here. Don't raise your hand. But y'all still smell like incense. I just want to say that. But you know what incense is like. You walk into a room of incense, and it's overwhelming. It's overpowering. It's beautiful. It saturates your olfactory senses so that you can't smell anything else. You walk out of the room. It's still in your, it's almost like you can taste it. And then it clings to your body. You like leave that hippie's room, and you walk around, and people are like, dang, dude, you smell like, you got hippie all over you. You smell like hippie. Because incense clings, all right? There's a fragrance that sticks. And so you got to know that this is what happens with prayer. Prayer rises to the throne of God. It saturates his heart. It saturates his heart. It clings to him. It's a beautiful aroma. He loves the smell of the prayers of his people. They got this. They believed it. They knew that when they prayed, God heard and he was going to do. You say, Pastor, so do we. I don't deny that, but listen, if we really did with all of our hearts, we probably would be praying more together. We probably, if we knew we had access, if we really believed, it was like, man, we can go together, and we can go right into the throne room, and we can beseech God and pray and seek his face. If we really genuinely held that deeply in our hearts, I think that we probably would be compelled to pray more together. And my prayer for us as a church is that that's what happens. But when we do, it pleases God. It blesses his heart. It saturates his heart. It clings to him. All right? Your prayers are not just bouncing off brass ceilings. Your prayers are not just like arrows passing by the heart of God. You've been praying for 10 years, 5 years, 3 years, a year, 6 months, a day. Those prayers have not left his heart. He knows. Some of you have been praying a long time for things, and you're thinking, you know what? God has not heard. And I want to encourage you tonight. God does hear. Don't stop praying. Charles Spurgeon had a very successful ministry, and he had been asked a number of times why it was that there was such a great success to his ministry. He said this, "My people pray for me." I mean, it was that simple for him. St. Augustine said, "Pray as though everything depended on God, and work as though everything depended on you." And I love this quote, "Prayer is not an escape from responsibility. It is our response to God's ability." So number four is this, you know, as things maybe get hotter and you're in the midst of opposition, make sure that you're praying. Their prayer consisted of three things. Number one was the sovereignty of God. Lord, you are God who made heaven and earth and the sea and all that's in them, who by the mouth of your servant David have said, why did the nations rage and the people plot vain things? Verse 26, the kings of the earth took their stand and the rulers were gathered together against the Lord and against his Christ. So I want you to think about a couple of things here. Number one is this, they leaned on the sovereignty of God. They said as they began, as difficult as it was, Lord, you are God. So you are in complete, total, absolute control. They go on to say, verse 27, for truly against your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed, both Herod and Pontius Pilate with the Gentiles, and the people of Israel were gathered together to do, notice this, to do whatever your hand and your purpose determined before to be done. So they looked to the sovereignty of God. They were reminded of the word. They prayed the word. If you don't know what to pray, maybe you struggle in your prayer relationship with God, go to the word and pray the word back to God. You'll know you'll be in the will of God when you do that. The second thing I want you to notice is this, that as they're praying, suffering was expected. You'll notice that as they're talking about what happened to Jesus, they acknowledge that all of that was actually according to the will of God, and then they receive that for themselves, that their suffering was also according to the will of God. So it was not a surprise to the church that they were dealing with opposition or suffering. In fact, Peter said it this way. He said, don't be surprised. Don't be surprised when fiery trials come your way because you are experiencing opposition for the gospel. The Bible says all who live godly in Christ Jesus will suffer persecution. Now listen, just real quickly, I want you to hang a left to John chapter 15. So John chapter 15, I want you to get your eyes on this, because this whole expectation of suffering came from the words of Christ, and we're all centered around the unbelieving world's reaction to his name. Verse 20, chapter 15, make sure you're turning there tonight. We're almost done. Verse 20 says this, "Remember the word that I said to you, a servant is not greater than his master. If they persecuted me, they will also persecute you. If they kept my word, they will keep yours also. But all these things they will do to you for my namesake." Check that out. "For my namesake, because they do not know him who sent me." The second thing I want you to note, and you got to understand this, is that suffering is expected for those who live godly in Christ Jesus. It's something we know that's going to come our way. I don't know if you've been following the news, but have you heard about the assistant coach who's been praying with his team up in the state of Washington? And he has been repeatedly told by the school district, he's been flagged for his faith, and they have said, "Hey, you can't do this." First of all, he was praying before the game. They said, "You can't." So he's like, "All right, I won't do that." Then he started praying after the game. They said, "Hey, you can't do that either." He's like, "Well, okay, I'm just going to kneel down on the 50-yard line after the game, and I'm just going to thank God." So he did that, and then all of these students, have you guys seen this? All of these students voluntarily have begun to gather, and it's become this huge thing. And now there's national attention being drawn to this guy and national opposition. He has been flagged for his faith. The reality is this, that as followers of Jesus Christ, Jesus said it himself, part of being a disciple is knowing that opposition is coming our way. The final thing I want you to note here is amazing. Verse 29, "Now, Lord," this is their prayer, "look on their threats. Grant to your servants that with all boldness they may speak your word by stretching out your hand to heal, and that signs and wonders may be done through the name of your holy servant Jesus." And when they had prayed, the place where they were assembled together was shaken, and they were all, what happened to them? They were all filled with the Holy Spirit, and they spoke the word of God. Don't you want that? Yes. I mean, don't you want that? You definitely don't want a mediocre, half-hearted substitute for your Christian experience. I look at that and I'm like, God, you are the same yesterday, today, and forever. Bring that to your church. Listen, this is the thing that blows me away. They don't pray, "Please take this persecution away." The third thing about their prayer that really is striking to me is that they pray to God, "Supply the power to preach." This is what they pray: "God, supply the power to be bold with your word." That's what they ask for. They don't say, "This hurts. I don't like this. This is uncomfortable. I don't like being in this position. God, please take it away." You know, I was reading a book a number of years ago. One of the guys who started the house churches in China, explosive movement of God. And, I mean, huge underground church, millions and millions of people that are being saved. He had, pretty soon he had a worldwide ministry. He would go to places in the West, like Canada, like America, like Europe. And people would come to him, and this guy suffered very, very serious persecution. I think we have his book in the bookstore. You should check it out. But this was what he heard people say to him in the West. They would come to him and say, "Hey, man, bro, we're praying that the persecution goes away. We're praying that God takes the persecution away and that the church in China is no longer persecuted." He said to them, "Stop praying that. Don't ask. Don't ask for God to take the persecution away, because the very reason the church is growing is because it is being persecuted." So I want you to think about this, all right? I'm not saying tonight that you need to pray for persecution. I'm not saying you should claim that in Jesus' name. I am saying to you tonight, there are things that persecution does. There are things that it does that are good. And I'm sorry for the issues with the mic tonight, but just stick with me, okay, and try to focus here. I'm trying to focus. Number one is this, Persecution purifies our souls. It purifies our souls. When there's opposition, when there's difficulty, what God does is he refines our hearts and he refines our motivations. It is an opportunity once again to realize that we don't live for ourselves, we live for him. The second thing I'd like you to consider tonight is that persecution unifies hearts. What you're going to notice here is that as persecution came from the outside, it unified the church on the inside. Sometimes when the church is not being persecuted and it's in a place of comfort, what happens is divisions begin to happen within the church. Because frankly, we have too much time on our hands to think about ourselves. And when persecution comes from the outside, you see that with this church, it unified their hearts. The third thing I'd like you to consider is this, is that persecution solidified their purpose. It solidified their purpose. For this church, it wasn't all about cosmetics. It wasn't all about unnecessary secondary or tertiary things. It wasn't all about pet doctrines. It was all about the gospel of Jesus Christ and seeing people saved. And what happens when the church is persecuted, it solidifies and distills the reason for which we exist. Someone wrote this. They wrote, "Do not pray for easy lives. Pray to be stronger men and women. Do not pray for tasks equal to your powers. Pray for powers equal to your tasks." This is the way the early church prayed. This is the way God's people should pray today. So the fourth thing is prayer. The fifth and final thing before my mic goes out is this. It's oneness. Verse 32, "Now the multitude of those who believed were of one heart and one soul. Neither did anyone say that any of the things he possessed was his own, but they had all things in common. And with great power, the apostles gave witness to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. Nor was there any among them who lacked, for all who were possessors of lands or houses sold them and brought the proceeds of the things that were sold and laid them at the apostles' feet. And they distributed to each as anyone had need." And Joseph, here we get an introduction to Barnabas. "And Joseph, who was also named Barnabas by the apostles, which is translated son of encouragement, a Levite of the country of Cyprus, having land, sold it and brought the money and laid it at the apostles' feet." The fifth and final thing is this. There was great generosity. Okay, so as the church was unified, as there was a oneness, as within the church, people were saying, hey, it is not every man for himself. People generously helped each other out. And I love that about the early church. This, by the way, is not justification for communism. It is not justification for communalism. We're not supposed to all sell our stuff and live in a commune together. Thank God that's not what the Bible says. I love you guys. But that is definitely not what the scripture says. One day we all will be living in the same building, the New Jerusalem, but we will not have our old nature. And we definitely need that before we're all living together. But this was what happened. What happened was the needs of other people outweighed their own personal needs. And so if someone was in need and somebody had something, instead of saying, hey, buddy, be warm and filled, love ya, God will handle that, God's sovereign, good to go, right foot of fellowship, hope it turns out all good for you. What they said was this, they prayed, they sought the face of God. God, I've got this. Is it that you're making a match here and this need that exists in this person's life can be filled by this blessing that I have? And so what they did is they were prayerful, they were selfless, they were generous, and they lived as one. And I think that we need that in the body of Christ. So five things, all right? Five things. I want you just to take note of these things, commit them to prayer, be spirit-led this week, press the edge a little bit, be willing to proclaim the name of Jesus, step out in faith as God leads you, be filled with his power, be obedient, be in prayer, be generous with the things that God has blessed you with. And I think in this era, we can experience everything that the early church experienced because God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Amen? Father, thank you for your word tonight. It's a blessing, God, to be in Acts chapter 4 and just a privilege to have a window into the early church. God, to be able to see the work, the great work that you did so faithfully. God, the church in its infancy. And God, knowing today that you're no different than you were then. Father, this is the desire of our hearts. Would you grant it? God, as we make our prayer to you, as we raise our voice, Father, would you gather up our prayers? God, would you collect them as flowers of praise to you, Father? May they rise as a fragrant aroma. May they be a blessing to your heart. God, may you hear, and tonight may you answer. I pray for all of the prayers that have yet to be answered. Thank you, God, for your timing and for your wisdom. Father, we confess tonight that you know better than us, and we're willing to submit. I pray for those weary hearts tonight, that you'd strengthen them. And God, tonight, that they would be encouraged to continue to be persistent, like that persistent widow, persistent in prayer. Tonight, as our eyes are closed and as we're in an attitude of prayer, I just want to ask this evening, maybe tonight you've come into this place, and the truth is you've never put your trust and faith in Jesus Christ. You've never been born again. Jesus said to a very religious man, he was a Pharisee, he was the teacher of Israel, he was a man who was supposed to be close and connected to God. He said to him, Nicodemus, you must be born again to enter the kingdom of heaven. And Nicodemus didn't understand what it meant. It meant to be born by the Spirit. It meant to be born by the will of God, not by the will of man or the will of flesh. It means to have your spirit regenerated by trust and faith in the person of Christ. In fact, Jesus said to him, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, so that whoever believes in him should not perish but should have everlasting life. And the same words that Jesus said to Nicodemus 2,000 years ago tonight are true for you. Whether you're a religious person, whether you're an unreligious person, you've never yet been born again, you've not believed in Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. Knowing with full assurance that you have the gift of everlasting life, tonight I believe that the sovereign God has brought you here to this place. It's a divine appointment tonight. And his desire this evening is that you would humble yourself and respond to the greatness of the name of Jesus. Peter himself, he said it like this, nor is there salvation in any other name, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. It is exclusive, but it is available for all. And so tonight, if you've never taken that step of faith, God is speaking to your heart. Tonight, you need the forgiveness of sins. Tonight, you need the grace of God. You want to leave this place as his son or daughter with the full assurance of everlasting life. Tonight, right where you're sitting, I want to pray for you, and I'm going to ask you. If God is knocking on the door of your heart, you'd say, Pastor, that's me. I need Jesus. I want to believe in his name. I want to be born again. Tonight, if this is you, would you raise your hand? Just acknowledge tonight God is speaking to you and you want to take a step into everlasting life. This evening, if God is speaking to you, stretch that hand up high. Let me see who you are. All right, tonight I want to ask if you need boldness to be a witness. Maybe you're in that place and you want to stretch. You want to stretch forth and you want to press a little bit. You want to be more bold with the name of Jesus. You want power this week to bring his glorious name, and maybe there's a personal relationship that you're dealing with right now, and you know God has been calling you to be bold and to share. Tonight, if this is you, I want to pray for you that God would grant you special boldness this week, and I'm not going to ask you to come forward or to stand. I just want you to raise your hand tonight God bless you. God bless you. God bless you guys. So many people tonight raising their hand. Praise God. Anybody else? Get that hand up high. I see your hands. It's awesome. God is so good. Look, this is what this means, that Vegas is going to get touched crazy this week. It's awesome. Is there anybody else? All right, you can put your hands down. Father, we raise our hearts to you tonight. We pray that you would empower us. We pray that you'd fill us. God, I ask for these lives. Thank you. Thank you, God, that you have touched and you've spoken. And God, even your Holy Spirit has illuminated our understanding and drawn our hearts to specific people. Now, Father, please bless your people. Fill them with your power. Strengthen them with your might. And give them that spirit-generated boldness to lovingly, humbly, faithfully proclaim the mighty name of Jesus. And Father, may there be this week many souls that are won into your kingdom. For we know, God, that the harvest, the fields are widened to harvest. And these laborers are ready to put in the sickle. God, we pray that you bless this week in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's all stand together. Tonight, if you need prayer, our elders are on the far side of the sanctuary. We would be blessed to lift you up in prayer. If you need prayer, may God bless you. May you have the privilege this week of leading somebody into the loving arms of Jesus Christ. In Jesus' name, amen.